ونستعين به جل وعلا ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. عباد الله، أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله، وأحثكم وإياها على طاعته، وأحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولا شيء مثله، ولا شيء قبله، ولا شيء يعجزه. قديم بلا ابتداء، دائم بلا انتهاء، لا يفنى ولا يبيد، ولا يكون إلا ما يريد. لا تبلغه الأوهام، ولا تدركه الأفهام، ولا يشبه الأنام. حي لا يموت، قيوم لا ينام. تعالى عن الحدود والغايات والأركان والأعضاء والأدوات، لا تحويه الجهات الست كسائر المبتدعات. ذلك بأن ربنا جل وعلا موصوف بصفات الوحدانية، منعوت بنعوت الفردانية، ليس في معناه أحد من البرية. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا وطبيبنا وقرة أعيننا ونور أبصارنا وبصائرنا وعظيمنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. صل اللهم وسلم وبارك وجدد وضاعف وعظم ومجد على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين. وارض اللهم عن صحابة رسول الله المخلصين المحسنين المتقين، بدءا بالسابقين الأولين ومن اتبعهم بإحسان وتمسك بالثقلين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، عباد الله، We are still with Surah Al-Qasas and with Musa alayhi salam, and inshallah we will finish probably inshallah next week will be the last one for Musa, because Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, his events in the Quran are very extensive and we can talk for years about Musa alayhi salam. So inshallah we will change to other prophets, as this is the request of many brothers. They wanted to hear about other prophets. Inshallah, may Allah make it easy. We left Musa alayhi salam, as you all know, that Shu'aib alayhi salam told him, I'm offering you my daughter in marriage, and there's one condition. This is the mahar. What's the mahar? He said that you have to work for me 8 years. أَن تَأْجُرَنِي ثَمَانِيَ حِجَجْ 8 years you work for me. And if you continue the 10, that is up to you, that's optional. And of course he gave him, like I said before, he gave him an incentive. And the incentive to be with Shu'aib is what? سَتَجِدُنِي إِن شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Remember before, a little bit before, when Musa alayhi salam, after he removed the rock from the well of water, and he gave the daughters of Shu'aib some water, and then he went to the tree. But he sat right under the tree in the shade. What did he say? Allah said on his behalf, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي لِمَا أَنزَلْتَ إِلَيَّ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَقِيرٍ. Look at this dua. And this is a beautiful dua. We should all remember it, memorize it. Oh Allah, meaning the dua, oh Allah, I am needy. Faqir means needy. Needy to you and what you give me. He has nothing. Musa alayhi salam had nothing. Sitting there in Madian with no food, no water. Basically he had the water from the well, but no money, no family, in a different place, strange to him. Nothing to depend on. Except Allah jalla wa ala. He says, رَبِّ إِنِّي لِمَا أَنزَلْتَ إِلَيَّ مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَقِيرٍ. And al-faqir, really, This is one of the meaning that has opposite meanings too. He was faqir, but he was rich. See, faqir doesn't always mean poor. It may mean poor in one perspective, but it doesn't mean poor in every perspective. Therefore, Musa alayhi salam was faqir ila Allah, so are everybody. Allah says, Ya ayyuha an-nas antum al-fuqara ila Allah. O people, you are fuqara, you are faqir to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, those people who have this, follow this way of Musa alayhi salam, and Isa alayhi salam, and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they also call themselves faqirs. See, many people that say faqir, they could be rich in a sense. But they are faqirs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they are needy for Him and they depend on Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Of course, from also here you see that where Musa alayhi salam saw the opportunity to marry. To marry someone who had these things that we should be looking for to marry. He didn't hesitate. Like we do now many days. Nowadays, daughter is, well, she's going to university. Inshallah, must be, somebody came, he wants to, no, inshallah, once she finishes her bachelor's degree, 4 years only. After the bachelor's degree, there's master's. And after the master's, there's also 3 years PhD. Where do we stop? The son, well, he's okay. He's a male. There's no problem. What do you mean there's no problem? There is a social problem in these things, dear brothers, and especially us in this community and in every community must deal with it. And the dealing with it is to face this problem. Nowadays, of course, we have a tendency, you brought it from back homes, everybody, whoever they came from, the tendency of painting a nice, rosy picture of everything. Things are not that rosy. And we have to deal with them. When you go to the doctor, there's a problem. If he tells you, look, there's no problem, you're going to be okay, go ahead, go home. What kind of doctor is that? Say, give me my money back. You go to the doctor, the first thing the doctor does, first identification of the disease, diagnosis, what's the problem, and then treatment. You cannot treat if you don't identify. You have to single out the problem and then treat the problem. So we can't close a blind eye to these things, dear brothers and sisters. And many people delay the marriage of their daughters purposely, or of their sons purposely, or they don't encourage them to do that. And I wonder what kind of sunnah are they following? Because the sunnah of anbiya was not like that. Nor the sunnah of awliya wal ulama was not like that. And by this causing a serious social problem, because these people are human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us human beings. People have needs and people have, especially when you are in situations where there's lots of things that you can see. You have access to everything. But everyone thinks, no, it doesn't happen to me, it happens to others. No. And we really have to prioritize these things. When you have someone, and when the circumstances are right and correct and appropriate, do not delay these things. As the further you delay, the further in problems you might get. And you might put them in these problems. Knowledge and seeking knowledge and going to universities, that's very important. No one is saying you should hold that off. But we humans and we Muslims should be multifaceted as we are, so you can do many things at the same time. Encourage your kids for that. To form a family unit, to form a family structure as early as possible, within the age of responsibility, of course. To start a family, to start something. Encourage them to have family values. Don't tell them it's okay later. Encourage them to do it earlier, not later. And that's also, we can take that from Musa alayhi salam and how he did it then. Of course, then Musa alayhi salam, as Allah tells us, he served for Shu'aib alayhi salam, not for 8 years, for 10 years. And that is because, of course, like I said, when someone does you good, you do them good back. Actually, you should be supposed to always do good, regardless what the others do to you. So if someone does you evil, you do not do evil back, because two wrongs do not make it right. We always face evil with good. And that's what should distinguish Muslims in any society from others. That you start and you initiate with good, regardless what the other party may do to you. And you will be distinguished like that. As the Prophets alayhimus salatu wasalam, this was their life and this was their seerah. Always people do them wrong and they do people good. People badmouth them and they say good things about people. People accuse them and they cease to accuse others. You have to always compare and contrast. Allah says, في سورة القصص, فَلَمَّا قَضَى مُوسَى الْأَجَلِ. When Musa finished the term 10 years, فَلَمَّا قَضَى مُوسَى الْأَجَلِ, after 10 years being in Madian, and now Musa has kids, and he has worked 10 years for Shu'aib, he has now some sheep, and he is grown 10 years older, he missed his family. Well, you remember, he left his brother and his mother, brother Harun, and his sister Maryam in Egypt with his mother, his brother Harun now is old, around almost 40 years. And you kind of miss them. And you more than anyone know these things, and I hope that we all do. If you have brothers or sisters elsewhere, you kind of miss them. And you want to talk to them. You want to visit them. And those of you who don't, please do. Take that phone and call them up. Or make a trip and go see them. Have the connection, not the disconnection. Musa has felt homesick. He wanted to go see his brother, his family. He knows Fir'aun is still in Egypt. What does he do? He made istikhara, and then he asked Shu'aib alayhi salam. Shu'aib was Nabi. He said, Ya Nabi Allah, I ask your permission to leave. And Sayyidina Shu'aib alayhi salam, go. You want to take your family? Go. He took his wife, he took his children, he took some sheep, and he left back on a trip 10 years later from Madian all the way back to Egypt. Fir'aun is waiting for him. But as you know, this is not one day. It took him 8 days to come, remember? And now it's going to take him almost probably the same. But here's the point. Allah wanted to honor Musa alayhi salam and wanted to account him with the prophecy. Wanted to make him a prophet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mashia and will was for Musa alayhi salam to be appointed and to be declared as prophet in that very night. He left from Madian towards Egypt, and Musa alayhi salam with his family, with his kids, with his sheep, he loses the right way. Where do I go? He got lost. The next night was still lost, and the night started getting very cold and very dark. And all of a sudden it started raining, and barq, lightning, and ra'd, and all these noises from what's going on? And of course, Musa alayhi salam's wife, she was pregnant and she was due. Look at this situation here. And Musa alayhi salam runs, of course, at that time, there are no places where you can put yourself and family under something when the rain is coming and when the cold is and the night is. So Musa alayhi salam tries to put something, some kind of clothing, and so he puts his family so he can light something. Lights a match or light some wood so he can get some heat and some light. It's too dark in the night, too cold, raining, thunder, storms, and his wife is pregnant and almost due. And he tries to light the wood and he cannot light anything. And with this situation and with this tough travel in the middle of nowhere, no one's around him, he sees nar. The Quran says, nar. The Quran says basically that he saw from next to the tour, فَلَمَّا مِنْ جَلِكُ طُورِ نَارًا فَلَمَّا قَضَى مُوسَى الْأَجَلَى وَسَارَ بِأَهْلِهِ آنَسَ مِنْ جَلِكُ طُورِ نَارًا. Allah says, when he went with his family, he saw from next to the tour, he saw nar, what appeared to him as nar. Nar means fire. He was happy. At-tur, we mentioned before, remember at-tur is different than the Jabal. And Jabal really supposed to be bold mountain. الطور is a mountain that is filled with greenery. And if you go now between Palestine and the south, all going to around Madian and all that area toward, almost towards Egypt, you'll see that still there, the greenery and all these things. Next to Jabal Tur, next to Tur, there is a valley called Madian. Called Tuwa. Called Tuwa, the valley of Tuwa. He receives fire coming from next the side of the of Jabal Tur. Next to that valley of Tuwa, and he tells his family, he tells his wife and his children. He says, "قَالَ لَهُمْ كُثُوا إِنِّي أَنَسْتُ نَارًا." Hold on. Very happy now. I have seen some fire. لَعَلِّي آتِيكُم مِنْهَا بِخَبَرٍ أَوْ جَذْوَةٍ مِنَ النَّارِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَصْطَلُونَ. Let me just go there. Stay where you are. Stay put. I will go and get either a khabar, means something, what's going on there, or at least I'll bring something of fire so I can bring it to you here so you can be, you can have light and you can have warmth. Because you have to, it's too cold, you need to have some warmth, and it's too dark, you need to have some light. Allah says now, let me just take you from Surah Qasas to Surah Taha, and it's corroborating the same meaning in a sense. فَلَمَّا أَتَى نُودِيَ يَا مُوسَى. When he came close to, he's trying to follow what? The fire. He's trying to follow the light that he saw as fire, and he goes all the way until he sees, reaches a place where he sees a tree in the valley of Tuwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, اخلعنا عليك. He receives the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah talked to him, Musa Kareem Allah, Allah talked to him, told him, take off your shoes, اخلعنا عليك, إنك بالوادي المقدس طوى. You are in the holy valley of Tuwa. And then Allah tells him, وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. And I have chosen you to be a, you need to be a prophet. فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. Hear and obey what you will be, what the wahi that you're going to get. إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدْنِي وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. I am Allah that no one should be worshipped other than me, so you should pray for my dhikr. Of course, in Surah Qasas, let me take you back to Surah Qasas. Dear brothers, please come forward because it is not recommended that people walk between people going back and forth while the khutbah is on. Inshallah, barakallahu feekum. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina. Now let's go back to Surah Qasas and see what happened with Musa. We left him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him that fire from next from the tree. And Allah tells us in the Quran, فَلَمَّا آتَاهَا نُودِيَ مِنْ شَاطِئِ الْوَادِ الْأَيْمَنِ فِي الْبُقْعَةِ الْمُبَارَكَةِ مِنَ الشَّجَرَةِ أَنْ يَا مُوسَى إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. That he comes to this tree and all of a sudden he sees a tree and the tree has a nur, light, all the way from the tree to heavens. Where's the fire? It's not nur, it's not nar, it turns out to be nur. Light from the tree, going all the way and lighting everything. Of course, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam was kind of scared in a sense, what is this? And then he hears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course he hears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran tells us that he talked to him and he told him, إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. I am Allah, the Lord of the worlds. This was a moment, of course, for Musa alayhi salam to be honored. For Musa alayhi salam to be given now the accountability of being a prophet and a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Three things I want to mention before we go on with what does this mean. Number one, in the ayahs of Quran as such, when we talk about the ayah of Quran, like these things, that has to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must realize, number one, that Allah jalla wa ala is not a body contained in a place. In other words, when Musa alayhi salam went to a shajara, to the tree, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a body contained in that place. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of all place and all space. قال تعالى, Allah said, الله خالق كل شيء. Allah created everything. Everything is created, but Allah is the creator. So number one, one must not think that Allah dwells in the creation, because this is kufr, waliyadu billah. Because this is giving Allah a size and a shape and all these things, which are measures and all these things. These are the characteristics of things and masses, not of the creator. These are characteristics of the creation, not of the creator. Why not of the creator? Because Allah told us in the Quran al-Kareem, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Nothing is like Him. That's one. Number two, we say that Musa alayhi salam received the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do we say he received the speech? We do not know the mechanism. Nor can we know. This is the point. Nor can we know the mechanism. We cannot capacitate the mechanism. But Imam al-Azam Abu Hanifa radiyallahu anhu wa arda, Imam Ahli Sunnah. And when you talk about Imam al-Azam, one should stand really in respect for Imam al-Azam radiyallahu anhu wa arda. الإمام الأعظم أبو حنيفة رضي الله عنه said this, ويتكلم لا ككلامنا. And he said this in الفقه الأكبر. Please go and review in his book called الفقه الأكبر, which means the great fiqh. The great fiqh means تفهيد. الإمام أبو حنيفة رضي الله عنه says, Allah is attributed with speech, but unlike our speech. ويتكلم لا ككلامنا فكلامنا. Why? Because our speech is بالحروف والآلات. We talk because why? We talk because we have all these tools of talking. And meaning what tools? Sounds and letters and alphabets. You have alphabet. If you speak Urdu, you have an Urdu alphabet. If you speak Arabic, you have an Arabic alphabet. If you speak English, you have an English alphabet. And you generate sounds. Allah's speech is not attributed with that. Some people, I've heard many people say that no, Allah recites with his own voice. This leads to kufr. Be careful. Allah is not attributed with sounds nor alphabets. Allah is the creator of sounds and the creator of alphabets. Allah existed eternally before no sounds or no alphabets were created. Jalla wa ala. And Allah is not subject to change. But the creation is very important. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa said, because our talk is huruf wa alat. We talk with letters and alphabets and sounds. He does. The third thing is when he saw the nur, when he saw the light, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, you should not confuse that with anything, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is nur as-samawati wal-ard, but not nur as in light. Allah does not consist of light, which is photons. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nur as-samawati wal-ard means the Hadi, the one who guides those in heavens and those in earth. Be very careful. Because Allah created light and darkness. So therefore darkness and light are created by Allah. Therefore Allah cannot be attributed with the creation, because He is the creator. Jalla wa ala, He said in the Quran, وَجَعَلَ الظُّلُمَاتِ وَالنُّورِ. Allah created الظُّلُمَاتِ, darkness and light. Very important. So we can go. So this is the Tawheed that the Quran came with. Now, many people say, how can we then submit? You say, Allah is attributed with speech, but we cannot understand how. You can't understand how. Very simple. The creator, the creation cannot capacitate the creator. Therefore, the Nun al-Masri, rahimahullah ta'ala, what did he say? He said, مَهْمَا تَصَوَّرْتَ بِبَالِكَ فَاللَّهُ بِخِلَافِ ذَلِكَ. He's an old scholar of al-Sunnah al-Jama'ah, radiallahu anhu, he said, whatever you may imagine in your mind, be certain that Allah is different from that. Because whatever you imagine is a creation, and Allah is different from the creation, Jalla wa'ala. He is the creator. Okay. Imam Abu Hanifa al-A'zam, radiallahu anhu, and Imam Abu Hanifa was an Imam in Tawheed. When you go back to the Tawheed of Al-Sunnah, you go back to Imam Abu Hanifa. He's the first one who written the book in Tawheed. Of course, the first book of Tawheed is Kitab Allah, Al-Quran al-Kareem. وَالسُنَّةِ الشَّرِيفَةِ. But from the scholars, you see Al-Imam Abu Hanifa رضي الله عنه. What did he say? an atheist, a man who doesn't believe in Allah, came to Imam Abu Hanifa. He said, Ya Abu Hanifa, when was your God born? When did he begin? When did he begin? متى بدأ؟ في أي سنة ولد؟ Imam Abu Hanifa looked at him. This man is what he's thinking. He's thinking of a creation. He's not thinking of the Creator Jalla wa'ala. He told him, Imam Abu Hanifa, look at this. He told him, what is before the number four? The man told him, before number four, there's number three. Okay. What's before number three? The man told him, before number three, number two. Very good. MashaAllah, you're smart. Huh? What's before number two? He told him, number one. MashaAllah, very nice. Before one, what is there? He said, there's nothing. He said, SubhanAllah, the mathematical one has nothing before him. And the one who has nothing before him, you're telling me that has something? The mathematical one doesn't have nothing before it. Allah has nothing before it either. Because he's the creator of beginnings. الواحد الحسابي ليس قبله شيء لكن الواحد الحقيقي ليس قبله شيء سبحانه وتعالى الله الواحد that nothing is before him جل وعلا because he exists eternally and everlastingly. Times are a creation of Allah. Time is a creation. Beginning is a creation. And Allah created the time and created the beginning and creates the ends جل وعلا. So he went and he brought other people with him. He said, no, Hanifa, he won. I have to bring other people. You know how some people are baqir, when they lose, what do? They seek assistance of shayateen, other shayateen. Shayateen from jinn and ins. Don't think that shayateen are only from jinn. No. A shayateen from jinn and ins. You have shayateen from ins as well. Allah says in the Quran, about the enemies of prophets, shayateen and ins, he was genuine ins. Ins were jinn. Actually, ins before jinn. Okay. So they came to him, they said, Ya Abu Hanifa, we have a question that you can't answer. He said, what? They told him, your Lord Allah that you worship, your God, is he liquid like water? Or is he solid like iron? Or is he like gaseous like air or like smoke? Now it's genius. You know, Abu Hanifa looks at him and looked at all of them. He said, have you ever been with someone who's dying? Any one of you? Yeah, we have. MashaAllah. Did you talk to him before he died? He said, yes. We talked to him. Was he talking? Yes, he was. Did you talk to him after he died? What do you mean? You're crazy? How can you talk to him after he died? We cannot. No, we didn't talk to him. Imam Abu Hanifa told them, why didn't you talk to him after he died? They told him he can't talk. Why can't he talk? They told him because his soul exited his body. He told Imam Abu Hanifa looked at them, he said, can you describe the soul for me? Is it gaseous like air, or solid like iron, or liquid like water? What is it? Huh? Everyone, we don't. SubhanAllah. So you can't describe a creation, but you want to describe a creator? So the soul, you cannot describe it, but you want to describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge? Therefore, these people, many people, yeah, now they're starting worshipping in a creation, believing in a creation. Not, they call them Allah, but they worship creation. Superman, something with a, like Superman thing. You know, like they see in the movies, because these movies and these cartoons, they put these things. They put the man that looks like Superman up above the cloud, with hands, feet, and two eyes, two hands, two feet, two legs, two hips, everything. What he had, but everything. Nose, lips, hips, everything. They call him Allah. And some people believe in something like that. And that he resides on in the seventh heaven. Then what was he before creating the seventh heaven? He created the seventh heaven. What was he before? Allah is the creator of all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of everything. And he existed in eternity when nothing else existed. No heavens, no earth, no galaxies, nothing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we go to the Tawheed. Let's go back to Musa alayhi salam. Because time is running after us. And now Musa alayhi salam was accounted with a message. Allah gave him the message. وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ Which means, I have chosen you. فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ And then he told him, إِنِّي أَنَا اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ Then he went, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, one more thing. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم في القصص وأن ألقي عصاك. What do you have in your hand يا موسى؟ وما تلك بيمينك يا موسى؟ What do you have in your right hand يا موسى؟ الله told them, موسى told الله سبحانه وتعالى, he told them, الله knows, all knowing. And this is my stick. أتوكأ بها وأهش بها على غنمي. ولي فيها معارب أخرى. It helps me stand and I steer the sheep with it and I use it for other things. Allah told him, ألقيها. ألقي عصاك. Leave it, throw it on the floor. On the ground, your stick. And then, Sayyidina Musa threw. Throw it. He threw it. All of a sudden, Allah says in the Quran, فَلَمَّا رَآهَا تَهْتَزُّ كَأَنَّا جَانٌ وَلَّا مُدْبِرًا وَلَمْ يُعَقِّدْ. And then all of a sudden he sees that this stick that he threw had turned into a pig. Like Jan. Jan doesn't mean jinni. Jan means a snake. Huge snake, like a python. But has the speed of a small snake. You know how small snakes have very speedy? Like a python with the speed of a small snake. And Musa alayhi salam, he saw this with big teeth and all. And Imam Tabari says big teeth. And very scary, he went back. And he said, what happened? He said, huh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, Ya Musa, أقبل ولا تخاف. Ya Musa, come back, don't worry. إِنَّكَ مِنَ الْآمِنِينَ. You are safe. Who are you afraid of? This is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are with Allah, you don't have to be worried about the slave of Allah. Yani when you are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't worry about the creation of Allah. Huh? But people always want to take, Ya Akhi, why do you take wasita? There's nothing between you and Allah. As to Ya Allah. Send the story. So Allah says, أَقْبَلْ يَا مُوسَى أَقْبَلْ وَأَتَخَفْ. Come and don't worry. Don't be scared. إِنَّكَ مِنَ الْآمِنِينَ. You are truly indeed, you are safe. You are a wali of Allah. And a wali of Allah is safe. No matter what happens to him. No matter what happens to him. Don't think that Yahya alayhi salam was killed. He was a wali of Nabi of Allah. But he was safe. By him dying, he was safe. That was the will. That's the submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's Islam. To submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What? Then all of a sudden he took it. Allah told him, سَنُعِيدُهَا سِرَتَهَا الْأُولَى. Take it back. Touch it, don't worry. Hold it, so he held it. He held the big snake, all of a sudden the big snake went back to being a stick. Allah, well, the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, one more thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Musa, أُسْلُكْ يَدَكَ فِي جَيْبِكْ. تَخْرُجْ بَيْضَا. Put your hand. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam was a little bit dark. He put his hand, Allah told him, which means put your hand in your pocket and take it out. Put his hand in the pocket, took it out, shining white, like pearls lighting. Allah told him, فَذَانِكَ بُرْهَانَانِ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. These are two proofs that you can take, these are two messages that you can take from your Lord إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَئِهِ. To Fir'aun. Go to Fir'aun now. Now your mission? We have armed you with Tawheed. Allah gave him Tawheed. Gave him Wahy of Tawheed. He gave him two signs. Huh? Because why didn't he give him two materialistic signs? You say, isn't Tawheed enough? Tawheed is indeed enough. If you talk in Tawheed to anybody, it's enough to convince them of the truth. There's no other way. Unless they disable their brain. No other way. But why did Allah give Musa alayhi salam these two supernatural mu'jizah? Because the people of Fir'aun, they don't believe, they're going to tell them, قُلُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, they're going to say, no, Fir'aun. Huh? Some people say لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا, no, Fir'aun. Okay? So he gave them something they understand. Because magic and all these things was very common at that time. So you take these things, if they ask you, show them. Of course, Musa alayhi salam, Allah told him, accounted him with the message now. Gave him two weapons, two very important weapons, and told him, go to Fir'aun. But Musa alayhi salam looked first, what was he taken with? What did he give him? What Allah gave him? Allah gave him two very important weapons, and those are more important actually than these two mu'jizah of the snake and of the hand. What did he give him? He gave him what he gave all the prophets. And all the awliya, and all the ulama, basically those are on the true path that follow the anbiya. What did he give Musa alayhi salam? He gave him a weapon of logic and non-violence. What did he tell Musa?
اذهب إلى فرعون, go to فرعون, فقل له قولا لينا.
Can you talk to فرعون softly? Allah does it. Which means, لينا means soft. Talk to him softly. Why? Talk to him in logic. Look, the messages of Anbiya from Adam عليه السلام to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, they're all logic. Huh? It all makes sense. And Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم comes to Quraysh, tells him, believe in Allah. He is the one who the creator of everything. The creator of heavens, the creator of earth, the creator of these idols. Don't believe these idols. Everything makes sense. Logic. The power of logic, not the logic of power. Remember? People use the logic of power, but no. Islam uses the logic, the power of logic. الحكمة. وَمَنْ يُتَى الْحِكْمَةَ فَقُلُوا يَا خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Now, what else did he give him? Non-violence. You go and you preach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in non-violence. The Anbiya alayhim salam, they preach in non-violence, all of them. Allah couldn't give Musa alayhim salam a nuclear weapon at that time. Here, if one doesn't believe in you, kill him. If one doesn't do this to him. No. This is not the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his prophets alayhim salatu wassalam. That they go actually in non-violence. And Musa alayhi salam, he spread the da'wah to Allah and he gave da'wah to Allah in non-violence. Isa, Jesus alayhi salam, also did the same thing. And Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also spread the da'wah of Islam in a very non-violent and logical method. And this is the method of all the people who follow them. And many people think non-violence means you do not fight. And that's wrong. There's actually a bigger fight in non-violence message. Why? Because you fight not to kill the other person. You fight to win the other person over. You fight not to eliminate their life, but you fight to give them life. You fight not to expire their happiness, but you fight to extend their happiness. To make it everlasting. That's why it's a much bigger fight. Many people don't think, no, there's no. Of course there's a fight. But the fight is much bigger than that. People lose it. You know what they say? When the reason Islam came to stabilize these emotions. To stabilize your emotions. What happens when people fight? You all say, oh, they lost it. He just lost it. Right? No, we don't want people to lose it. We want people to gain it. We don't want, Islam doesn't want people to lose things. Islam people want people to gain, not to lose. We don't want you to lose it. We want you to get it. We want you to stabilize these things. It's not a matter of what they did to you yesterday or what they have done to you today. It's a matter of how will you respond to what they have done to you. Will you be as evil? Nonviolence, as a matter of fact, is a very strong weapon. And that's the weapon of the Prophet ﷺ that they came with. And look at them, they all were tortured, but none of them was given a weapon, but weapon by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as weapon of killing people. They were all given a weapon to give life to people, no matter what happened. And therefore, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at this hadith, subhanallah, this all sciences that they talk about, psychology and sociology, it's all in the Quran and the hadith. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَيْسَ الْقَوِيُّ بِالسُّرْعَةِ الْقَوِيُّ, hadith sahih. Al-Qawi, the one who's strong among you, is not the one who loses it. Sur'ah means he goes crazy. He gets very angry. The strong one is not the one that gets extremely angry. وَإِنَّمَا الْقَوِي, who is the Qawi, Ya Rasulullah? Who is the strong one, Ya Rasulullah? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Qawi, the one who is strong indeed, is the one who controls and has stable emotions when he's angered. People now make books about this hadith. They don't know that Rasulullah 1425 years ago said to them this and gave them the entire summary of it. And Islam doesn't believe in violence. And Muslims are not violent. And should not, we should teach our kids and tell them that Islam is not violent no matter what happens. Because we have a bigger fight. It's very easy to destroy, but it's very hard to build. Very easy to destroy. Look what happened in Quraysh. They go these little munafiqeen, huh? They talk about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the best of the creation صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. They said he is magician, he is a liar. What is this? One word. What does it sound? It's a bomb. To what? To destroy his reputation. So people don't listen to him because they were scared. What were they scared of? A weapon he has, a gun he had. Yes, it's stronger than a weapon, stronger than a gun. The logic of Haqq and the non-violence. And those are very strong. Of course, I will finish with one thing, but before that, I'll take a break. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر وأشهد أن سيدنا مولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم خاتم الأنبياء المعتبر صلى الله وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي وعلى آله أهل الفقه والنظر والعلم وأثر وعلى من بآثاره مكتفى واعتبر. When Allah told Musa go to Fir'aun, Musa looked at himself. He was alone with his family. And now he has to go all the way to Misr, to Egypt, to talk to Fir'aun and all his people. Even though he was strong and he was willing, but in a motion for mercy, he asked Allah. He said, "Oh Allah, I have إني قتلت منهم نفسا فأخاف أن يقتلون." I have by mistake killed one among them 10-15 years ago. I'm afraid that they will kill me. And I have a brother Harun. He's in Egypt. وأخي هارون. He is هو أفصح مني لسانا. He is much better spoken than me. Look at Subhanallah. Musa is telling Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, he's much better spoken than me. Can you will you allow him? Will you permit him, oh Allah, so that he can accompany me also, be with me to give da'wah, to be also a prophet with me, so he can support me because he needs support. The prophet, even he is the best of the creation, he still needs support. And I will take you, and we will finish in 1 minute, but I will take you back to the seerah of the Habib al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Al-Nabi al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the people, they wanted to kick him out of Mecca, who did he take with him? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. As-Siddiq al-Akbar radiallahu ta'ala alayhi. He took, he said, because he needs someone. In times when nobody stands with you, and you are on haqq, but nobody is there. And he took Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu used to walk one time on his right, one time on his left, one time behind him, one time in front of him. Al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Ya Abu Bakr, why are you doing this?" He said, "Ya Rasulullah, I am scared that they will throw an arrow at you from the right, so I will take it if it comes to the right. If it comes to the left, I'll take it. If it comes in front of you, I'll take it. And if it comes from behind you, I will take it." And I will take you to another example before I finish. And we will finish with this. Is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the da'wah first. And he gathered all of Quraysh and he said, "Who's going to follow me to believe in La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah?" And everybody, Abu Lahab started telling, "Tabban laka lihada da'awtana." "You are a loser. That's why you're calling us to worship Allah. Who's this?" Huh? "Who's going to stand with me?" The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Nobody's standing, nobody's doing anything." And his cousin, Ali ibn Abi Talib, was 11 years old. He stood up, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, I will support you. I will support you." And the people of Quraysh, they looked at him and they started laughing. But they didn't laugh for long after that. They laughed, but remember what they say in this country, who laughs at the end, laughs for a long time. And that's exactly what happened. The haqq doesn't need the quantity, it needs the quality. And that was the quality of the Sahaba al-Kiram, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. The quality of people. The quality of these men and the quality of these women that shaped who we are nowadays. That all of these things go into their and their a'mal, and their thawab, and their good deeds till the day of judgment. So be part of good. Be part of truth. Don't be part of maybe, maybe not. Al-Islam is not about maybe, maybe not. Al-Islam is not about suspicion. Al-Islam is about substance, not about fiction. It's about fact. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما
كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين وأعلي مولانا كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه، ومن أراد بهم غير ذلك فاجعل دائرة السوء عليه. اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك ردا جميلا، آتي أنفسنا تقواها، زكها أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ربنا ومولاها. اشف لهم وارضانا وعاف مبتلانا وفك أسرانا وارحم ربنا بفضلك موتانا. اللهم اغفر لنا ولآبائنا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حق علينا ولمن على الخير أعاننا ولمن عن الشر أبعدنا ولمن أوصانا بالدعاء. تقبل لهم صيامنا وقيامنا، وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وسلم، وأقيم الصلاة.